gathered here in the harbor of your safety. We thank you for fellowship and family. We ask that you will strengthen us, restore us, and inspire us with your love. Lord, fill us with your peace, so that as we journey onwards, we would pour out your love and grace to others. We ask that our souls would catch the wind of your Spirit, so that we would take your promises to all of the earth. Amen. So we can all stand for the call to worship given by Michelle Prud'homme.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We gather as God's people, bringing our fears and pain.
Knowing that when our spirits have grown cold, God rekindles the gift of faith in us.
We gather as God's people, hanging our broken hearts on the branches of the tree of life.
Knowing that while friends may turn against us, God transforms enemies into sisters and brothers.
We gather as God's people, hungering for healing and hope.
Knowing that even when life is no picnic, God prepares a feast for us.
If you would turn in your hymnals to hymn number 520, we'll sing Nobody Knows the Trouble Place, please.
Thank you.
We have a special musical performance this morning by Sam Garrett, who's on her way here now, like a rock star. Inside your bulletins, you will find a yellow slip of paper. On this yellow slip of paper are the words to Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, performed by Sam Garrett.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are Annette Wahl.
testimony, given our testimony of what God has done and is doing in their life, and I'm sure it's going to be uplifting to everyone who's attending service today. Annette, please come join us up front.
I think I'm hiding if I stand behind there. I'm taking your lead. Let me know if you can't hear me, though. My name is Annette Wahl, and I'm here to talk about something that I titled after the bulletin was printed, but the cleansing of our souls, and that's SOULS/SOLES. And that's because I'm going to talk about feet. And I've worn my sandals this morning. And I would invite any of you who would like to take your shoes and socks off, or off your feet, But go ahead. Hips are pretty up here already. But we're going to be thinking about our feet, and we're going to be thinking about what our feet mean to us. And then we're going to be taking care of our feet. We're going to have a little cleansing of our souls back there at our little cleansing station. At the end, we can go back there. And I'm not here to talk about a foot fetish that I have. I'm not obsessed with feet. I just think about feet a lot. And I'm thinking about that's how we all got here in some way, shape, or form this morning. And I think that we're all headed in the right direction because we are here to share this time together, and I think that's a good start. Our feet have a story to tell about our journey in life and where we've been and maybe where we're headed as well. I think about feet all the time. I think about when I was a child, my own feet. I had some little issue. I always had little cracks and crevices in my feet, and my feet hurt a lot, and my mother would make me wear these special socks that she thought would help out, and I was kind of embarrassed about it, and we were always fussing with my feet, and maybe that's kind of where it started. And then as an adult now, as a woman, I have to say that shoes are one of my favorite accessories, and I tend to kind of tend to my feet a little more. I put polish on them. I enjoy my shoes, and I'm on my feet at work all day. I work in a hospital. I'm a nurse, so I'm always thinking about what I'm wearing on my feet and how to take care of my feet. And my feet talk to me throughout the day, and they talk to me when I get home. I also think about my patients' feet. I look at all of my patients' feet every day. I'm always looking at feet. And that's because they have a story to tell me through their feet. I look for wear and tear on their feet. I look for signs of disease. A lot of our chronic illnesses show up in our feet. People that have diabetes have a lot of foot problems, heart problems, circulation problems. We start to see all that in our feet. And so I also think a lot about the feet of my patients. I tend to work with people who are very, very seriously ill and tending towards the end of their life. And a lot of what I see in my patients' feet is a lot of disuse. They've not been on their feet much. And I see changes that happen in their feet. Our feet are, you know, when we lay down, our feet are kind of like this. We tend to spend less time on our feet. When we're laying in bed, our feet kind of slump down a bit. And I think about a patient that I met one time, and he was a cross-country truck driver. And so he spent, I don't know how many hours a day, sitting in his truck driving with his, you know, sitting on his bottom with his legs hanging down and using his feet to use the pedals. But because his feet were always down for all those hours throughout the day, you could see the changes in the circulation that had happened through the years. I think about my own father's feet. My own father is now actually, he's seriously ill. He's nearing the end of his life. And his feet need to be cared for. And he's always had kind of gnarly feet. His toes have been kind of crimped up and changes in his toenails. He's not even embarrassed. He never wanted any of us to look at his feet. But now, when I tend his feet, he's very appreciative of it. And I don't talk about his feet. I don't comment on his feet. I just provide the care to his feet. There's many biblical references about feet. Some of them you're going to see in a bulletin. We'll talk about those today. I think about Psalm 23. It talks about walking through the valley of death. Fear no evil, for thou art with me. And it comforts me to think about that passage. Not only is my own father is nearing the end of his life, but many patients that I take care of are as well. So I'm always thinking about that and about his death. The other thing is, as I'm going throughout my day, I try to have these triggers in my mind, my triggers for prayer time. And it really bothers me if I'm at the end of my day and I'm thinking about my day and I never took a moment to think about praying. And I may be having something go through my mind that is very frustrating and I never turn to God throughout the whole day. So I try to have these triggers. Maybe I'm waiting for the elevator. I'm feeling a little impatient. Hey, that gives me 30 seconds to talk to God. Maybe I'm waiting for somebody, waiting for my kids to come out and jump in the car. I'll take that moment to just sit and say, forget that worrying about time. Let's just talk to God. One of the other big triggers, and this may be a little strange, but when I wash my feet at the end of the day, that is a trigger for me. I told you I'm on my feet a lot. I'm actually in an environment that's full of germs, bacteria, viruses, whatever. So I spend a lot of time washing my feet. I scrub them with the washcloth. After I'm done scrubbing them, I put the washcloth down and I kind of rub my feet on them. And I'm letting all my troubles go. I start to turn all my thoughts over to God at that point. I don't know why that connection worked for me, but that's what worked for me. I pray for strength and guidance, and I pray for God to point me in the right direction with my feet. I think about acceptance, and I think about forgiveness of my sins. And I think about my own strength to forgive others as well. I'm thinking about journeys, and I'm thinking about my spiritual journey and what brought me to this church and really has brought me to be closer in my faith. Really, it started with a friend of mine when I was in college. She had always attended church, and I was always wanting to know more about her spiritual connection, and she ended up at this church, and so then I would come with her to this church, and things just took care down from there for 30-some years now, I think, actually. And I think about some of the struggles in my life. I have a lot of substance abuse and addiction in my life and around me, and especially in the people that are very close to me. And one of the things that I really appreciated about the Methodist faith in particular is when we take communion, that blood of Christ is non-fermented. And for me, that has always been very, very meaningful. And just that open table for communion has been very powerful for me to feel like we offer that to anybody and hope that everybody can get out of taking communion without you know, accept communion. And of course, we think about Jesus cleansing the disciples before they get down to the Last Supper. Their feet were, the disciples were probably, their travels, the path, they were walking maybe in sandals. Their feet probably were soiled, and this was going to be a sacred time, so they would cleanse feet. And Jesus then offered to cleanse the feet of the disciples. And very humbling that he would do that to the disciples. That just makes me think about washing the feet too. It's a lifelong process to wash the stain of sin we experience as we walk through this world. So, again, I invite you all to take a look at your own feet and think about your journey that you've been on, where you're headed, and looking for any signs of the wear and tear, and in your struggles in life, and we have a little table set up. My friend Denise is a nurse as well, and we have a little cleansing station to wash our souls. Got some baby wipes to scrub down with. Everybody can take a pair of fresh socks, and I got some little powder, and everybody can use it in the day, and certainly remedy things that are ideal. Thank you.
Long story short, I just went to church.
Mom, thank you.
Amen. Yes, amen. At this time,
there's a lot of great things happening here at Copeland. Come on, Bible studies, to our music, to our education, and of course, our spiritual needs with Reverend Heights. But recently, over the past 8 weeks, we've all come together for Bible study. And it's been a joyous program, which is continuing tomorrow with the book of Genesis. But over the past 8 weeks, we saw our groupings go from 2 to 4 to 6, to as high as 2. That's something to praise God for. We praise God every day for that. So with that, we'd like to present to our recent group who finished Bible study, the book of Matthew, a little token of our appreciation. Ted, can you come up here, please? Ted Emerson.
Wisdom bestows well-being. My son, do not forget my teachings, but keep my commands in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you peace and prosperity. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. And then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him, and He will make your path straight.
Thank you again. At this time, if we can all rise and say the Lord's Prayer with one.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you may be seated, you can open up your hymnals to hymnal number 145, Morning Has Broken. Source of material for others. John's gospel is wonderful because his gospel seems to be written with those that struggle with unbelief in their mind. Often when I ask people, which book of the Bible should I start with? I say, the Gospel of John. The Luke's rendition of Jesus' life, I love because it is written as history. And the style seems of the Old Testament made, but very inspirational. There seems to be a lack of fairness in the casual reading of the announcements of both John and Jesus' conception. Zacharias asked a question on 1:18, and it is treated as doubt, and he is left mute for the next 9 months. Mary asked a question, 1:34, and she is no way chastised or disciplined. Honestly, this may have never, ever occurred to you in your reading of those stories. But it always, yes, always, bothered me. So this morning I examined the story more closely. And here is what I've come up with. When Gabriel announces to Zacharias the notice of his soon-to-be-conceived son, he shares with him all the permanent details, including the one that assures him of law. This is his response to your petition. Zacharias is now old, so this must have been a long ago petition. A reminder that God never forgets our prayers or our requests. At the end of the description, Zacharias asks a question, the long question. How will I know this is for certain? Luke 1:18. When Gabriel announces to Mary the notice of her soon-to-be-conceived son, he also shares with her all the permanent details, including the one that assures her of why. Favored one, the Lord is with you. At the end of the description on all the permanent details, Mary asks, how can this be, since I am a virgin? Luke 1:34. The only thing I can see is that Mary was not asking for a sign. She is asking about functionality. She knows what she is, and she also knows what she is unwilling to do. Lose her virginity prior to the appropriate time. Asking how can I know for certain is a question of doubt. So God gave him a sign. Asking, how can this be, since I am a virgin, is a question of function, method. It should be almost better stated, I believe. But can you let me know through how you're going to make this possible? Because I haven't had sex, and I know you're not going to ask me to break God's moral law. That is how I understand the seemingly incoherent responses to two similar questions in chapter 1. I find great comfort when I pray. I'm talking with Jesus and the Father. There are moments of indecision, moments of pain, moments of joy in laughter. Our prayers are heard. We pray for family, we pray for friends, we pray for loved ones who are no longer with us. Is there anyone here that you would like us to pray for? And while you're thinking of that, in your yellow slip, in your bulletin, is our prayer request for the month of May.
Well, I saw in the paper this morning that Paul Kramer's father died. Oh. And the memorial service here at 2 o'clock on Sunday.
Is there anyone else who would like us to pray?
My friend Larry, he's going destroyed will not bury your soul.
Anyone?
I changed my mind.
Let us take a moment.
I have a joy. I ran into Lee Hoffman yesterday, and she was getting therapy, and her hand is now able to open after decades.
Wow. Let us take a moment silent prayer. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we commit ourselves to follow your word in every situation that we face. We trust that you are the answers to our prayers. Please watch over our church family. Heather Nowak, who recently had some surgery. Ray Lawson, Bill Bartley, Kelly Haley, Gail, Mikhail, Lisa Pickerel, Michelle Mankey, Trudy Bisner, George Hallis, Lee Hoffman's joy of her hand and her continued recovery, Vera Miller, Dan Holcomb. Also, please pray and bless Annette Wahl's family, especially her dad, who's ending his journey here on earth. We also pray for Paul Kremer's father, Bob, who passed away recently. We pray for Marty, who's ill. We ask for God's strength. And we also pray for our church leadership. We also have special prayers for Peggy Gill and the passing of Peggy's sister. And we continue to hold Florence Lucas and her family in our prayers at the loss of Barney Lucas at age 92. As we pray for our leadership, we also pray for Reverend John and Laura Heiss and the Heiss family as they make the adjustments they must make in order to assume Reverend Heiss's superintendency of the Crossroads District. We pray for all Christians worldwide. We pray for all the members of you here at the Abbey Gather Service and our SAC Lunch Program and our Monthly Clothing Program. I believe that you know everything that I need for it. I rely upon thanking you in advance for your presence in every circumstance that comes my way. Make us worthy, Lord, to serve those people throughout our community, who live, suffer, and die in poverty and hunger. Give them through our hands this day their daily bread. And by understanding, love, and hope, give them peace and give them joy. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. You can open up your hymnal number 206. I want to walk as a child of God.
Thank you.
I was going to wait until Neil was done.